might come in sick, but Jesus took a beating on his body so you can receive your healing. It doesn't matter what you're walking through, what you're going through, God has special things for you today. Now, this morning's service is going to be a little bit different. As you can see, the platform is set up a little different. We're going to still do our song service, but this morning we are doing a dramatic presentation of the Easter resurrection story, and that's why you see these various things that are set up on the stage. And before we get started, because I'm good at forgetting, I want to take a minute to thank everybody that's worked so hard to make this happen. Sherry and Robert worked real hard just last night on getting this stone decorated. You'll meet the stone in a little while. Sister Joanne worked hard, Sister Karen, Brother Robert, Brother Mike, everybody worked real hard to make this happen. And I want to thank each and every one of you that were here helping with that. And wherever Sister Joyce is hiding, I want to thank her because she put all this, oh, she's in the back, okay. Are you a backslider?
No, I'm back here doing this job first.
Just thank you for doing everything you're doing. So, before we get started, though, I want to make a couple of announcements, and then we'll open in prayer and ask God to have his way. Next week on Saturday, 7:30 in the morning, we have a men's breakfast right here at First Assembly of God. So, guys, I need help to make that happen. About 6 o'clock in the morning, we need to start cooking. So, any guys that could come and be right over here across the hall in the fellowship hall, help me get the eggs and the bacon and all the different things ready, biscuits and gravy, all that good stuff. If you'd be here at 6 o'clock in the morning, that would be great. So we need help for that. Now, the Saturday after that the 30th of this month, we have a clothing outreach ministry. That will run from 10 in the morning until 2 in the afternoon. Now, this is coordinated by the ladies in our church. And Sister Joyce and ladies, I thank you for all the hard work that you're doing with it. But it's their job to coordinate. We could have guys come and help us hand the clothes out, you know. Sister Joyce is going to need help on Friday night. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
6 o'clock? 6 o'clock Friday night. You see the sign up front, in front of the building out back. So just if you could help to organize, set up, get ready to hand out Friday night. And then Saturday, we need some people to help hand out all the clothes for people that might need it. After we're done at 2 o'clock, there's still more work to be done because we need to pick everything up and put it away because Sunday morning, we're gonna use that facility for children's church. So there's a lot of work going involved in this, and we surely need some help. Now, at the same time we are doing the clothing outreach, we are also having a food ministry outreach. We'll have cases and cases of food to give away. I will need some help. We've got to go to Waco to Shepherd's Heart Ministry and pick everything up and bring it back here. So I'll need some help to kind of load up the trailer or a U-Haul, whatever we're going to use to get it in. And the food is going to start at 10 a.m. and be over at noontime. So guys, gals, whoever you might be that might have free time on the 30th, we're going to need help with that food outreach, and we're going to need help with the clothing ministry. So just a couple of things with that to keep in mind. I do want to remind you that we are not going to have service tonight. Okay, tonight we're going to dismiss. You can spend time with your family and travel or whatever it is you might want to do. See if I miss anything. I think that's about it. Can you think of anything?
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
On the 23rd of this month, the women's are going to have their breakfast, and we are not getting up at 6, and we are not cooking eggs. We're meeting at Lucy's at 9 o'clock. Come just eat with us and fellowship and have fun. And this Tuesday here at 7 p.m. is the ladies' prayer meeting, so I hope to see a lot of y'all out there. Come in there.
Amen. Brother Mike, if I missed anything.
I think you got it all.
All right. I would remind our gentlemen that are on the board that this Thursday night at 4 o'clock will be a very special board meeting. So please be here. One of our district officials, Brother Lewis, is going to be coordinating that board meeting. So guys on the board, if you could be here Thursday at 4 o'clock, that would be absolutely wonderful. I won't join you until 5:30 or 6, but whatever you have to share with Brother Lewis, that's great. So I think that's about all of it. Let's stand. Let's open up this service with prayer and ask God to just have his way. Amen. Father God, we thank you this morning because we know that you sit on the throne. You always sit on the throne in heaven. Earth is your footstool. Father, we humbly submit to you. We want you to have your way in everything that's said and done today. Father, we confess that we're needy people. There are people not here because they're in the hospital. Some of our loved ones are on hospice. Some are in the hospital. Some are just struggling at home because they're ill. We ask you to send your word to where they are and heal them. Touch them. Raise them up, Father God, by your power on this Resurrection Sunday. Let them feel the touch of your Holy Spirit on their lives. We commit this time, we commit this service to you. We ask you to have your way. Lead us, guide us, and direct us in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You can be seated if you would like. Brother Mike.
Thank you, Lord. I'm going to leave that alone. I'm going to stand over here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Glad to see each one of you here this morning. Could I ask you to stand with me one more time? Gospel calisthenics. Up and down, up and down. Amen. Praise the Lord. But we got, praise the Lord, you can do that. Amen. If you weren't able to do that, that would not be too good. So we praise the Lord. So sing with me this morning. We're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The man who came and died for us, washed away all of our sins, and gave us healing through the stripes on his back. And he is alive. Amen. Praise the Lord. Sing with me this morning. Alive forevermore. Alive, alive, alive forevermore. My Jesus is alive, alive forevermore. Alive, alive, alive forevermore. My Jesus is alive. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. Thank you.
Hey guys, just real quick, I want to let everybody know we are having an Easter egg hunt this morning. When service is over, I know none of the kids like that. Y'all have to take all the chocolate and give it to Brother Kevin back there. See, there he is, right? Look at it. Looks like Santa Claus. That's him. We hope you have a good time with it. So, parents, if you brought children with you, children, if you brought your parents with you, when service is over, what we would like you to do is kind of line up by the door in this hallway here. If you come out of the church, down this hallway, there's a door that goes outside. And when they have things set, when they have things ready, they'll get us out there. And parents, please feel free to take pictures or whatever you would like to do. And I think I'm done.
Jesus comes to Jerusalem as a king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethany on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. And these are the perspectives from the donkey." How the donkey saw it.
"I am a very proud donkey because I was chosen to carry the King of Kings into Jerusalem. The disciples put their cloaks on me so there would be covers for Jesus to sit on. As we entered the city, the people yelled, 'Hosanna,' and laying down palm leaves and cloaks for me to walk on as I carried the Messiah into Jerusalem."
And now from the perspective of the palm leaves.
"I am so glad that the people chose me as the leaf to wave and lay over the road along with the cloaks as Jesus entered the city. When Jesus entered the city, I could just feel the joy in the air as the people who started to wave me."
Matthew 26:14-16. Judas agrees to betray Jesus. "Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and asked, 'What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?' So they counted out for him 30 pieces of silver. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over." This is from the perspective of the coin.
"We are the coins that the priest gave Judas Iscariot when he came to them and offered to hand Jesus over to them. So he took the 30 of us to betray Jesus the Messiah with a kiss. We never thought we would be used to pay for someone to be killed."
We are now at the Last Supper, Matthew 26:17-26. "On the first day of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, 'Where do you want us to make preparation for you to eat the Passover?' He replied, 'Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, the teacher says, my appointed time is near. I am going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.' So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. When the evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table for the 12. And while they were eating, he said, 'Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me.' They were very sad and began to say to him, one after the other, 'Surely you don't mean me, Lord.' Jesus replied, 'The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it was written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born.' Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, 'Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi.' Jesus answered, 'You have said so.' While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he
broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body. This is from the perspective of the bread.
I was the lonely piece of unleavened bread sitting on the table that was prepared by the disciples for the Messiah. After telling who would betray him, he picked me up, gave thanks, and broke me and told the disciples to take and eat, for I represented his body. So the disciples ate.
Matthew 26, 27 through 29. Then he took the cup, and when he had taken thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is prepared out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. This is from the perspective of the cup.
I was a single goblet sitting on the table that Jesus' disciples had prepared. After you broke the bread, he picked me up, gave thanks, and told the disciples to drink because it was inside me. What was inside me represented his blood. And Jesus said that his blood would be poured out for the forgiveness of sin. So the disciples drank.
We are now in Gethsemane. Matthew 14, 32 through 42. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little further, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Can't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping. Because their eyes were heavy, they did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough, the hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." This is from the perspective of the praying man.
That night in the garden, the disciples could not stay awake long enough to put me together and pray like Jesus had asked them to. That night in the garden, Jesus prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." After he had returned the third time to the disciples and found them still sleeping, he told them that the hour had come and that his betrayer was coming. As Judas came to the garden, he greeted Jesus with a kiss to show the soldiers who he was. He saw Jesus being taken away. The hands that had folded in prayer were now tied behind him, and he was led away.
Matthew 27 through 27. All the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them. But he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of the soldiers around him. This is the perspective from the whip.
When Jesus was handed over to the soldiers to be flogged, I was the whip that was used to put stripes on his back. I'm made of leather that has pieces of glass and sharp rocks attached to it that dig into the flesh of the person being whipped. Each time they hit Jesus' back, I grabbed his skin and ripped it to make him bleed. The stripes that I made were prophesied that they are for the healing of all your diseases. So just remember what kind of pain Jesus felt as I ripped his skin.
Now we went through the garden, we went through the Lord's Supper.
Jesus has taken the stripes upon his back. And now we're going to go into the stage. And this is sort of taking a shorter time than I thought it would. So let's take a moment and just think. Jesus is tied down like this. And his back has no clothing whatsoever on it. And they've taken that whip that has the glass and the bones in it, and they're hitting his back and ripping his skin. And that was all done for the healing of our diseases. For our healing, he took the stripes upon his back. So when you are sick, you say, Jesus took those stripes upon his back for me. For me, he took those stripes upon his back. Matthew 27:28-31. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. Hail, King of the Jews, they said. They spit upon him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took the robe off and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to be crucified. Just think of the crown. And this is from the perspective of the crown of thorns. And just think of this being placed upon your head. And how you would feel if this was put upon your head.
I am the crown that was placed on Jesus' head after the soldiers took him and stripped him of his clothes. I have very long thorns that are very sharp. When I was placed on his head, the soldiers took the staff that they had given him to hit him many times, pushing the thorns farther and farther into his scalp, making the blood pour out from his head and run down his face. I could feel the agony that Jesus was feeling as I sat upon his head.
He's got blood running down his back. Now he has blood running down his face from the thorns being stabbed into his head. And y'all know how it hurts when you get cut on the head, how profusely you bleed. This is what Jesus was doing with the crown of thorns that was placed in his head. Blood was just running down his face, and then he had the blood running down his back. This is the suffering he's done for me and you. Matthew 27:32-44, the crucifixion of Jesus. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrus named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. Just think of Jesus. He already had the stripes on his back and the thorns in his head, and he's carrying this cross on his shoulder. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots and setting down. They kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two rebels were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left.
Those who passed by hurled incense at him, insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to be destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself." Just think of Jesus hanging on that cross. And he's doing all of this for those people. And they said, "Save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he couldn't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we'll believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now, if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. But I want y'all to remember, one of them, he asked Jesus to forgive him. And what did Jesus say? "This day you will be with me in paradise." Because he knew what he had did and realized what Jesus was doing when he asked Jesus for his forgiveness. So that's what we are here to do, is to ask Jesus to forgive us of our sins. But we're going to see the perspective from the cross's perspective.
"I am the cross that Jesus died on for all mankind. As I was carried by Jesus and then by Simon down the road to Golgotha, I was wondering, what did this man do to deserve to die like a thief? All he did was good for people. He taught them, he fed them, he healed them of their diseases. As the soldiers laid his body on me, I was wondering why he did not call on his Father to save him. Jesus knew what his mission was, and I was part of that mission. So when you see me, remember that an innocent man gave his life on me so that you might live. Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice then. He died on the cross for me and for the sins of the world."
So when you see a cross in the store, it's not just a pretty item to hang in your. There was a sacrifice made on that cross. So many people I know have crosses hanging in their homes, but do they really know what happened on that cross? Do they really know what suffered on that cross? But they laid that cross down, and they put Jesus' body upon that cross. Now remember, he has stripes on his back, and he has that crown of thorn on his head, bleeding. And they lay his body down, and he stretches his arms out. This is how much he loves you and me. Then they took the hammer and the nail. So we're going to see this from the perspective of the hammer and nails. First will be the hammer.
"I am the hammer that drove the nails into Jesus' hands and feet. The soldiers went to the right arm and placed the nail and raised me, then slammed it in me upon the head of the nail several times. When they finished with that side, they went to the other side and did the same thing then, and then went to his feet and did the same thing. Each time the soldiers hit the nail, I felt the agony of Jesus."
So just think of that agony he was feeling as they were driving it in to his hands and his feet. Now we're going to go to the perspective from the nail side.
"We are the nails that were driven into Jesus' hands and feet. We are made of iron, and it takes a lot of force to hammer us in. They only used this when they wanted someone to die faster than normal, as soldiers were driving us into his feet and hands. were wondering why. Why would they want him to die faster than normal? They would just hammer and hammer until it went into the wood of the cross, and it made sure that the innocent man drove us in, and the blood started to flow from this innocent man for the sins of the world.
So remember, he was nailed to the cross just for you and just for me. If you was the only one, he would have did the same. So now Jesus is hanging on the cross. He's bleeding on his back. He's bleeding in his head. He's bleeding from his hands and his feet. The blood that will never lose its power for you and for me. It will save us. It will heal us. So remember this picture in your mind as we go on. Here's Jesus with his arms outstretched and his feet crossed. And they got one nail in his feet and one in each arm. And he's hanging there. He's got blood just pouring out. And now we have soldiers that's at the bottom of the cross dealing for his clothes. So this is the perspective from the dice's point of view.
We are the dice that were used to cast lots for Jesus' clothes. As he was hanging on the cross above the soldier, each time they rolled us, they just laughed and mocked Jesus. Jesus was in agony as the soldiers were playing, but they did not care because they were too busy gambling for his clothes.
Let me read from John 19:31-37. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be placed the Sabbath. Special Sabbath, but the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath. They asked Pilate to make the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. This is from the spear's point of view.
I am the spear that one of the soldiers was carrying. I was used to make sure that Jesus was dead. It was common for them to break the legs of the people on the crosses to make sure that they were dead, but they saw that Jesus was already dead. So they used me to double check. When they pushed me in, I felt the blood and water flowing out of him. This was proof to the soldiers that he was dead.
So now we're going to the burial of Jesus. He suffered on the cross by being nailed, being whipped before he got to the cross. So he is profusely bleeding. His blood is flowing. Then they pierce him from his side. He's got blood and water coming out from the side. So just think what Jesus looked like. Is he undescribable? Can you imagine? I know we've seen pictures on Facebook. We've seen pictures and everywhere. But you know what? That really can't truly capture what Jesus looked like. It really can't. I can't imagine somebody doing that just for me. You know, and he did this all for us. So now we're going to go
burial. John 19:38-39. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the perspective from the linen's point of view. I am a fine linen that Joseph carried with him when he went to take Jesus' body off of the cross. As they took Jesus' body down from the cross and wrapped it up in me, I felt so honored to be used to wrap the body of the Messiah in. They also put spices on him, as it was custom to do. When they finished wrapping Jesus' body, they took him and laid him in the new tomb that was in the garden nearby. Matthew 27:62-66, the guard at the tomb. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure upon the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go, make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. So they took that rock and they rolled it up. The stone was already rolled away. So they came and they put a seal on it. They probably put something on it and then put a seal on it. But you know, a seal can't keep Jesus down. It can't keep him down, as we're going to find out later. But they put that seal on there so they could see if the tomb had been tampered with. Well, let's go ahead and read Matthew 28:1-4. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. This is from the perspective of the stone.
I am the stone that was used to seal the grave of Jesus. As Joseph placed Jesus in the tomb, I was just outside waiting to cover the hole to secure the grave so no one could steal the body. I am a very heavy stone, and it would be hard for anyone to move me. After Joseph placed Jesus in the grave, I was rolled into place. I was not left there alone. They had placed soldiers at the grave because Pilate believed someone would try to steal his body. Then after a few days, there was a violent earthquake, and an angel came and rolled me away and set upon me.
Matthew 28:3-6. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they struck and fell like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be
be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lies. This is from the perspective of the empty tomb.
I am the tomb that was created for someone else to be buried in. But I got to hold the most important person in the world, the Messiah, who died for all the sins of the world. Why do you look in here? He is not here. He has risen just as he said he would. I am holding nothing but the grave clothes that Jesus wore. Come and see. He is not here. He is risen. He is risen. He lives forever. He is risen.
He is risen.
day.
All he asks is for you to come fast, for him to forgive you, and he will help you.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you will turn your life around. He will turn your life around in a way that you can't imagine. But just say, he took the nails, he took the stripes, he took the thorns.
But he's no longer dead.
He's no longer dead. He's alive and well. We may not can see him with our physical eyes, but we know him by our spirit. By his spirit, we know him. And I want to give the opportunity, if there's anyone here that would like to give their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ after what you've seen today, the word's been presented. But Keith, if you want to come join me up here, our pastor. And if there's anyone here that would like to come and give your heart to the Lord, we're up here to pray with you, to lead you to the Lord. And if you have any other special needs that you have, we're here as well. We will be dismissing in a little bit, but I think this is the most important part of the service, is if those are here that need to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior.
Or maybe even you've already accepted Christ. You know you got saved at some point in your life, but you drifted far away. And you might in your heart be saying, I'm not what I used to be in the Lord. I'm not where I need to be in the Lord. The invitation is for you. And
yes.
I would challenge you to be bold enough, to be brave enough, to step out from where you are. Jesus stepped into your mess. He wants you to step out of yourself. So if you're here and you want to give your heart to Jesus or rededicate your life, I want you to come and join us up front. I know there's people here that are feeling that shaking inside their heart. You don't even know what's going on. You're feeling guilty and you're feeling sad and you're feeling confused. That's the Holy Spirit talking to you. He's asking you to listen to that voice. And finally, you might be here to say, you know what, Pastor? All is well between my heart and my Lord. And that's a great place to be in. But not only when he rose from that grave, when he walked out of that tomb, every sickness, you know, when he died as part of the presentation we saw, he took every sickness, he took every disease, he took everything that could possibly bother you, your addictions, he took your depression, he took your psychological problems, he took your marriage problems, he took your troubled life, any problem that was there, and those died with him on the cross. The good news is that when he rose from the dead and he walked out of that tomb, he didn't carry any of that with him. He left all of that behind him in the tomb. So if you're here and you want prayer for healing, for deliverance from addiction, get rid of your depression, whatever it might be, would you walk up to the front and allow us to pray you, pray with you? That would be the greatest privilege that anybody could have. We did it different today. We're going to go do Easter egg hunting in a few minutes. So. Let's do this. We're going to close in prayer. We're going to dismiss. It is a little bit early, but that's all right. I want you to be able to spend time with your families, spend time with each other, enjoy this day. Reminder that we will not leave this evening. We're going to close in prayer. And if you're here, you say, you know what, Pastor? I never did raise my hand, all right?
Smile, you're on candy camera. Father God, we thank you for this time that we've had to be together in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the word that went out. That your word take root in our hearts. May we grow, may we change, may we be delivered by your word. You sent your word and healed us, delivered us from all of our destructions. So, Father, let your word take root and grow. Help us be better tonight than we are today and better tomorrow than we were yesterday. Father, help us to walk with you, stay in your presence. I pray your blessing over everyone that's here. Father, may you walk before them. May you guide them. May you protect them. Yes. Be with each and every one, Father. We'll give you praise and thanks.